So hello, welcome back. This is the second part on Bayesian networks on learning and model selection. After all, this is a lecture on machine learning. The first discussion is on maximum likelihood learning with complete data. Complete data means that in the network, for example, let's go back to the medical network, where was that? Yeah, here, in this one. So you might have data from several patients or from several individuals. And for each patient, you have complete information. You know if this patient went to Asia, is a smoker, has lung cancer, has tuberculosis and bronchitis, has positive x-ray and dyspnea. And so that's what I mean by complete information about an individual. In this case, the maximum likelihood learning is quite simple. So we introduce this parameter theta ijk, which means that this is the probability that a variable xi, so this can be any variable, so xi is in state k. So if it's binary, it's just 0, 1, otherwise it can have several states. Given that the parameters, the parents of xi are in state j. So this is just some configuration enumeration of the parent states. In that case, the maximum likelihood estimate for theta, which specifies this conditional probability, essentially, because this is the conditional probability we are interested in, the maximum likelihood estimate is the number of times we have observed this configuration so that xi is in state k and the parents of xi are in state j, so this might be 10 or 20 or whatever, divided by the sum of nijk, where we sum over k. So we consider all states of xi. So this means how often when the parents are in state j, has the node xi been in state k? That's why you normalize. So if this is 20 and this is 40, then you get one half out. And this is a conditional probability in the Bayesian network. So the the probability of a node given its parent, which is exactly the probability distribution we need in the design of a Bayesian network. So that's a very simple, and it's very simply depends on the counts, and there's nothing mysterious about it. You just calculate these counts and calculate this quotient, and you get the result. This can also be generalized to a Bayesian approach, to a map, maximum a posteriori probability estimate. Because if you have, if the number of patients or individuals is relatively small, the maximum likelihood estimate might exhibit high variance. We discussed this problem before. So there, maybe you want to combine the information which comes from the data with the information an expert can give you. So you want to combine the manually or the human expert definition of these conditional probabilities with the counts. And the approach is quite simple. So the expert has to define something like a virtual count, this alpha ijk, which is larger or equal to zero, and it's sort of the confidence that this particular combination occurs based on the expert's opinion. So if these alphas are very large, then he has very high confidence that this count is true. And because these counts, of course, are also the virtual counts are normalized, so what really counts is the relation between the different counts, between the different case, but also the absolute value, because the absolute value sort of indicates your certainty in this prior belief. And the MAP estimate is very similar to the maximum likelihood estimate, only that you add these virtual counts to the real counts. And these virtual counts appear in the numerator and in the denominator. And if you assume we don't have any counts, then the n is zero, and we simply have the alpha ijk divided by the sum over the alpha ijk, which is our prior belief about this conditional probability. If we don't have any, if the alphas are zero, then so the virtual counts are zero for the reflecting the prior probabilities, then we have the maximum likelihood estimate, and we can combine it in a sensible way to take into account the prior knowledge of the user, of the experimenter, and the actual counts. So this is a very nice and easy way, a very obvious way of and easy to understand way of how you incorporate prior knowledge with pure pre-count data. Then often we have missing data, so we might have information about n patients, but not all information is available for every patient. So in this medical example, sometimes you might not have the information if a particular patient has visited Asia. It was not asked in the interview, or the patient never did an X-ray, so you don't have the information about the X-ray, or you don't really know if the patient has lung cancer. Maybe you know this patient has tuberculosis and bronchitis. So the information in this situation where Bayesian networks are applied is often incomplete. And so far we have pretty much ignored this issue, which of course also occurs in supervised learning. And in particular, it's an issue if some of the input variables are missing. You have missing information in the input variables. Then dealing with this situation can be more or less complex. There are some simple heuristics, but a principled approach which can be applied to a probabilistic model is the EM algorithm, it's a pretty famous algorithm. It stands for expectation maximization. It can be applied to maximum likelihood estimates and MAP estimates, both in both cases. And it's applicable if the reason why something is missing, it should be missing at random or completely at random. And the simple explanation would be, or intuition would be, the fact that some variable is missing should not depend on the value of the variable. And so if rich people don't answer the income questions, but the poor people answer them, then it's not missing at random, and your estimate of the average income of a neighborhood would be biased towards low incomes. So the fact if something is missing should be independent. So if a random number of rich people and poor people don't answer the door, and you don't get that information, then it's okay. Now that would be missing at random. But it's a little bit more complicated story. So the EM algorithm, essentially there are two steps. There's the E step and there's the M step. And you apply both a few times. So it's an iterative algorithm. You do E and M and E and M and E and M. maybe 10 times, and then you have maybe something like convergence. So let's consider a particular data point or patient L. In the E step, we calculate the probability or marginal probability for of interest given the known information. So you don't assume you don't know anything, you assume you have partial knowledge. And the known information in the data point is we call DL. And we have a current estimate of the parameters. So it could be initially a random small number, but maybe we are all already in a process of optimizing. So we have theta hat, which is our current belief about the best estimate of this parameter. And this can be done by belief propagation or application of the junction tree algorithm. We are using belief propagation now. And then we get, so the expected count, nijk, is the sum over all data points, where we, in each data point, we estimate using belief propagation or junction tree algorithm the probability of that xi assumes the value k and the parents of xi assume the configuration j, right, conditioned on the available data information dl and the current estimate of the parameter theta hat. So this is so a little bit more general than the junction tree or the belief propagation we have discussed, because you have to estimate the joint probability of both of the node and also the parents of the nodes. It's a little bit more complicated, but essentially it's a belief propagation algorithm. And if we know the state for a particular patient, then this probability is either 1 or 0, and otherwise it's a number between 0 and 1. So essentially we do an inference step, and for each data point we estimate the probability of the parents and the quantity we're interested in. And this is our, and then we sum over all data points, and this is our estimate of this nijk count. And then, based on the e step, we apply the m step, which is the maximum. For example, for the maximum likelihood estimate, we divide the expected counts of nijk divided by the expected count, where we sum over j. So this gives us a new estimate of our theta hat. And then we use this new estimate in the e step again, here over here. So we take this guy and put it in here. And do the e step again, get our new estimates for the counts, plug them into the m step, and we have to go forth and back a few times until convergence is reached. And EM is often very, very stable and very well behaved. So what can be proven is that it doesn't increase. It might stay constant or improve the likelihood in each iteration, so it cannot be unstable. I should check this text again and maybe fix it. But EM also has issues with local optima, so if you have a bad initialization, it might converge to a bad local optima. So you might run the algorithm a few times or try to get a good starting point. So EM by itself introduces some local optima by which would not exist in a situation with the complete data, because in the complete data we know the rules for we just have to get the counts. So there's no local optima, but when we do the EM with the missing data, we can also run into local optima problems. So EM is, yeah, it's quite famous and is also applied in other situations. For example, two a little bit more fancy models. So we briefly discussed the HMM, the hidden Markov model. Another interesting probabilistic model is the Kalman filter. And for example, HMMs are trained, which is in a way a special case of a Bayesian network, is trained using the so-called Baum-Welsch algorithm. And this is exactly the EM algorithm applied to this particular Bayesian network, the HMM network. We can also do learning of the Kalman filter with an offline training is also performed by a form of EM. Online learning typically uses other algorithms. So if you want to only move forward in time. But it has a lot of other applications, for example, a mixture of Gaussian mixture models. They have to use the EM algorithm. So it's quite prominent in machine learning. So the E step is really an inference step, and it has problems, or it's difficult again if you have many missing data and if the network is quite large. So here often people sometimes use approximate inference steps, for example, Loewi belief propagation, which we have discussed, or Monte Carlo, Markov chain Monte Carlo methods, like Gibbs sampling, mean field. So there are different ways to approximate the E step, but the M step is typically quite easy, no? Because it's just doing an update on the virtual counts. Yeah, so far, I didn't say that explicitly, but we assumed table representation. So the conditional probability of a node given its parents can be represented by a probability table, which is normalized in a particular way. So the entries are non-negative, and the corresponding sums should be one. But essentially, what we are modeling there are conditional probabilities. So we can also replace the table representation by other representations, for example, decision trees, which we haven't discussed yet in the lecture, or neural networks, or log linear models. So there are also people do that sometimes. Now, if of course you lose a little bit the interpretability. You cannot ask an expert for weights in a neural network. But if you have, if the ta tables, if nodes have a lot of parents, this might be a better solution than because you're running also into this exponential problem to specify a node, a dependency of a node depending on many parents with a table. Would also require exponentially many data points, which you don't have. So you want to simplify this conditional probability distribution, and for that you can use neural network decision trees or log linear models. Now, because a Bayesian network essentially is a set of conditional probabilities, and we have modeled them before with log linear models, for example. So far we assumed the nodes and the arrows are given, but the quantification of the dependencies must be learned from data. You can also go one step further and assume that the structure of the network is unknown. So you just have a bunch of data points, which often occurs in practice. The situation, And you want to also need you need to also learn the structure of the base net, so there's no expert which gives you these nice causal dependencies. And maybe you want to even discover causality. In structured learning, several points need to be considered. There are models which are structural equivalent. For example, in a Bayesian network with only two variables, A and B, one might show that there is statistical correlation between the two variables, so they are not independent. But based on just two variables, A and B, it's impossible to say decide if B is the cause, A is the cause of B or B is the cause of A. So you can only say, okay, there is a link, but I cannot tell you which direction. Unless, of course, you have prior knowledge about something. For example, that the complexity should be low, or the mapping should be unique. And there should not be possibility that the consequence can have two different values at the same input. So if you put the additional constraint, then maybe it is possible to decide, but without additional assumptions, it cannot be decided. But colliders, so nodes where arrowhead meet, can be uniquely and unambiguously be identified. Yeah, also you have to be careful. So this last remark here. So Bayesian network, also the dependencies, depend on the population from which the data was collected. So if you, for example, consider patients with lung problems and then design a Bayesian networks under that case, you will get different probabilities than if you have a network which is designed or learned from data from the general population, which where somebody has a smaller probability of having a lung problem. Or you might consider people who show up in the doctor's practice. They come to the doctor because they have a problem from patients who don't have a problem. So this can also influence the probabilities, at least some of them. So where is it? Do I have a collider somewhere? Sorry. So this is a collider, of course, and then this can be identified. So I thought I had more slides here. Let me go back to the medical example. So this is a collider, and this gives you information about directionality, or here dyspnea. It's a collider, so one can identify in structured learning that the arrow should go from here to here or from here to here, but it would be not possible to decide just based on data if a visit to Asia causes tuberculosis or tuberculosis causes visit to Asia. Based on just collected data, this would not be. No, this is the case I just described. You cannot decide if A causes B or B causes A if you have this situation. But if you have colliders, then it's clear that the direction must be in this way. I think I have some examples later. Okay, maybe just go on with the lecture. And there, essentially, or often you're doing some form of a greedy search because also the structural search for the best causal structure based on data has local optima. You have to deal with many local optima. So you can start with an initial network, for example, a fully connected network with some random connections or an empty network, and then you make changes. So you remove an arc or link, or you add a link, or you change the direction of a link. Of course, you have to be careful that you don't introduce directed circles. And then you accept the change when the cost function improves. And otherwise, you reject the change. So you greedily try to improve your cost function. You can repeat it with different initial conditions, and then maybe select the model which gives you the best score according to the cost function. You don't always have to go in the direction of minimizing the cost function. In approaches like simulated annealing or genetic algorithms, with some probability you would also agree with changes that make your cost function worse. And the reason is that you want to find a good optimum and you don't want to get stuck in a local optimum. So what are the cost functions? So here are two examples. One is called, we already know the BIC, the Bayesian information criterion, and applied to this problem, it would be 1 over n, so 1 over the number of data points. But this is with complete data, and as we assume we have complete data, times log of the likelihood function minus m divided by 2n, m is the number of parameters, times log n. And you might, because otherwise, of course, a Bayesian network which is completely connected has the best score. But of course, you want to also discover independencies. So you need to have something which penalizes two complex networks. And that's done by this penalty term in the BSC formula. So that then might converge to networks which are not completely connected. You can also, in this data, in this situation with complete data, you can also do the Bayesian modeling and can calculate this term, the probability of the data given the model explicitly. Now we discussed this before in the lecture on model selection, and we went to the example of supervised learning with fixed basis functions. But here also in this case, now in this case we can explicitly calculate this term, the probability of the data given the model, which is the basis for model selection. So essentially when you do the search, you're evaluating this function and try to find the model which is gives you the best score under this function. And for Bayesian network, this can be calculated explicitly. So it's a product over all data points. And then you have the product over all j and the product over all k. And this is the so-called gamma function, which is you can look up in a table, or you can probably have function calls for that in MATLAB and similar cases. So here is the gamma function applied to alpha ij. So this includes the case you have prior knowledge about the dependencies. And here is the count. And here is the product over ijk and plus the counts and divided by the gamma function applied to alpha ijk. And the structural learning has been applied for gene expression data, for example. So it's a map of gene ID and expression in different experiments. And so you want to find out which gene influences which other gene. And then you get networks like this one shown here on the right, which sometimes gives you causal directions for the cases where it can be identified. You also define these driver genes, which influence many other genes. I mean, I would always be a bit doubtful about the results of structural learning in Bayesian networks, because typically you don't really have a lot of data points and there's ambiguity. But people are doing it and sometimes they get reasonable results. So the first approach to structural learning was to define a cost function, so-called BIC or the Bayesian score, and you try to find the structure, so the links and the direction of the links, which gives you the best performance for this particular cost function. There's an alternative approach. You might be familiar with statistical testing, which essentially tests for does a dependency exist or not exist. So if you study statistics, you probably learn about different hypothesis testings. And you can apply this idea also to learning in Bayesian networks. Here it's called constraint-based methods for structural learning. So here I think, I guess I have an example. Let me see. So in the example one, in image one, M and S are marginally mutually independent, but they might become dependent if J is available. So this structure can be identified if the data indicate that the state of Mary, whatever this is, healthy or sick or whatever, the state of Mary and the state of Susan are independent. So if you just test are these two individuals dependent or their properties dependent, you find no, they're independent according to our test. But Jack is dependent on Mary and Susan, and in particular, Mary and Susan become dependent when Jack is known. So we didn't really explicitly and we didn't really in detail discuss dependency assumptions in Bayesian networks. But we know that this is the right figure if Mary and Susan are dependent, but Jack is dependent on both. Which also means that if Jack is known, the state of Jack is known, dependency on Mary and Susan suddenly occurs. And this is this important collider situation where having information about a descendant, here in this case Jack, implies that suddenly Mary and Susan have a dependency. So, and this can be checked by statistical tests. And if they confirm this situation, then we can identify the causal structure between these three variables. In all the other cases, we cannot really distinguish because they all show the same independent structure. So, for example, here, Mary and Susan are dependent if you just check for them because there is a path from Mary to Jack to Susan. But if the state of Jack is known, Jack's blocks the information flow from Mary to Susan because this is a known quantity. So this will be shown if we find this out in the statistical test, then either two, three, or four might be true, and we cannot really decide because all of them have the same property. Susan and Mary are dependent, but if Jack is known, they become independent, and also in this case. So this again shows you the difficulty in identifying causal structure in Bayesian networks. Only situation one can really be identified. So if you do structural learning, causality has many faces. So in a lot of work, people assume there's a causal structure, and then they just want to quantify these causal dependencies, or maybe show that one causal dependency is not really there, so the value is zero. If you do causal discovery based on structural learning in data, which we more or less described in this lecture, then you have to be really careful because one assumption is that the world under consideration is causal. Another important assumption is that all relevant information is part of the model. So you have to have a complete domain, which is where everything outside of the domain acts as random noise, as random influence on individual nodes. If you can assume that, then you have a chance to really identify causality. Otherwise, the problem is if there are some variables which you don't model, but they influence more than one variable in your Bayesian network, then they imply dependencies which cannot really be explained by the dependencies in the data you're observing, and you get these spurious correlations, which we discussed before the issue in the medical domain, where we emphasize that confounders can be an issue. So these are variables which influence more than one variable, but which are not included in the model. And the same is true here. If you do structural learning in a Bayesian network, you might get a Bayesian network out which gives you a reasonably predictive power, but doesn't really have a causal interpretation. Sometimes, fortunately, we have temporal information available, which of course limits the dependency structure. So something can influence things which are later in time, but not the other way around. And this is the basis for what is called Granger causality, which analyzes essentially causal structures in multivariate time-dependent models. So concluding remarks on the discussion of Bayesian networks. So they are used as expert systems in the medical domain. They're still quite popular there because the program is to query medical experts, and that can be done. And in my team we have designed Bayesian networks by interviewing doctors, and that works reasonably well. The probabilities you're getting are quite good, and they're quite willing to give them to you. So that's why maybe in the medical domain, these Bayesian network-based expert systems are quite successful. The underlying theory of directed links between nodes can be used to derive the likelihood of complex models, for example, HMMs. So this Bayesian network way of thinking about a domain can also be quite useful and successful in other domains we haven't been discussing. There's also something called Bayesian networks. So the two main representatives of these type of networks with nodes and links between nodes are Bayesian networks and Markov networks. In Markov networks, you don't have the direction on the links, so you have a formalism which works with undirected links. So they typically don't have a causal interpretation, but in some domains, they're quite good models for modeling a domain. And I simply don't cover them here. If you're interested, please look at the literature. Yeah, they are the most important instances or representatives of the class of graphical models. So that sometimes considered to be the more general term. Graphical models and Bayesian networks and Markov networks are the most important examples. In this lecture, we focused on Bayesian networks with discrete variables, but you can also apply them to continuous variables, and then sometimes you're assuming a Gaussian distribution, and then you have Gaussian Bayesian networks or Gaussian Markov networks. But I think the more common and more important situation is really the discrete situation we have been discussing. Yeah, here's a probably not quite up-to-date list of commercial or free Bayesian network toolboxes, if you want to play with that. There are also some commercial companies. So Eugen here, for example, was quite successful for a while. But I would assume that there's a lot of free public domain software around if you want to play with Bayesian networks. They can be quite fun because you can play with design expert systems and then do all sorts of inference. And sometimes you get interesting but surprising results. So yeah, I would encourage you to do that. There's also software around for learning parameters or for structural learning. So if you want to go in this direction, there's an quite interesting tool base available you can work with. Yeah, so I think Bayesian networks are an interesting tool to cover. I mean, they're basically, initially they are, we discussed them as expert systems, but also in the learning aspects are quite interesting in particular. For example, next week, I hope I can discuss reinforcement learning. I haven't quite finished the preparation of the slides yet. And there, for example, you will also see that directed graphical models give you a good basis for understanding the situation in reinforcement learning. And there are many other situations where this is really a very nice framework, for example, to understand belief propagation. Belief propagation comes up in different domains under different names, but having a basic understanding from this view of looking at it as a Bayesian network can be really quite helpful. Okay, thank you very much for your attention.